Blackstone Audio presents People Who Eat Darkness, the true story of a young woman who vanished from the streets of Tokyo and the evil that swallowed her up, by Richard Lloyd Parry. This book is read by Simon Vance. For Mum and Dad. Among the old men who secretly came to this House of the Sleeping Beauties, there must be some who not only looked wistfully back to the vanished past, but sought to forget the evil they had done through their lives. Among them must be some who had made their successes by wrongdoing, and kept their gains by repeated wrongdoing. They would not be men at peace with themselves, they would be among the defeated, rather, victims of terror. In their hearts, as they lay against the flesh of naked young girls put to sleep, would be more than fear of approaching death and regret for their lost youth. There might also be remorse, and the turmoil so common in the families of the successful. They would have no Buddha before whom to kneel. The naked girl would know nothing, would not open her eyes if one of the old men were to hold her tight in his arms, shed cold tears, even sob and wail. The old man need feel no shame, no damage to his pride. The regrets and sadness could flow quite freely. And might not the Sleeping Beauty herself be a Buddha of sorts? And she was flesh and blood. Her young skin and scent might be forgiveness for the sad old men. Yasunari Kawabata, House of the Sleeping Beauties. Prologue. Life before death. Lucie wakes up late, as usual. A line of daylight flares at the edge of the shrouded window and pierces the dim interior. A low, cramped, colourless space. There are posters and postcards on the walls, and blouses and dresses on overburdened hangers. On the floor, two human shapes on two futon mattresses, one head of blonde hair, one of brown. They sleep in T-shirts or naked beneath a single sheet, for even at night it is too hot and clammy for anything but the thinnest layer against the skin. Outside, crows are cawing and scuffling on the telegraph wires that tangle between the buildings. It was 4 in the morning when they went to sleep, and the plastic alarm clock shows that it is almost noon. The brown head remains huddled on its pillow as Lucie puts on her dressing gown and goes to the bathroom. She refers to her home in Tokyo as the shit house. The bathroom is one of the reasons why. 6 people share it, plus their overnight guests, and the room is vile with their parings and detritus. Exhausted tubes of toothpaste curl on the edges of the sink, sodden lumps of soap drool on the floor of the shower, and the plug hole wears a slimy cap of clotted hair, skin, and toenail clippings. Lucy's own vanity products, which are numerous and expensive, are brought into and removed from the bathroom on every visit, along with her combs, brushes, and makeup. Her toilet is lengthy and fastidious, a practiced drill of shampooing, rinsing, conditioning, soaping, toweling, patting, smoothing, cleansing, moisturizing, absorbing, tweezering, brushing, flossing, and blow-drying. Lucie epitomizes the distinction between simply taking a shower in the morning and grooming. If you were running late, you wouldn't want to find yourself behind her in the queue for the bathroom. What does Lucie see when she looks into the mirror? A full, fair face, surrounded by naturally blonde hair falling below the shoulder. A solid chin, strong, even, white teeth, cheeks that lift and dimple when she smiles. A rounded nose, sharp, closely plucked brows, and small, dark blue eyes that angle away from the horizontal. Lucie deplores her slanty eyes and spends long mirror hours wishing them away. They are subtly and unexpectedly exotic on a woman otherwise so fair-complexioned, so blue-eyed and long-limbed. Lucie is tall, 5'9", with a good bust and hips. She pays anxious attention to the surges of her fluctuating weight. In May, after the effort of travelling to Japan, moving into the shithouse, and finding work, she was slimmer than this. But after a few weeks of late nights in the club, she has drunk it back on again. On her worst days, she is filled with contempt for her own appearance. She feels bloated and saggy. She is tortured by self-consciousness about the birthmark on her thigh and the dark mole between her brows. A dispassionate observer might describe her with old-fashioned and faintly equivocal words such as buxom and comely. The brown-haired girl on the other mattress, Lucy's best friend, Louise Phillips, is far more of a conventional beauty, slim, small, pert-featured. But for most of the time, to other people at least, Lucy communicates a confidence and an ease. Her way of laughing, of moving her hands as she speaks, of shaking her hair, her habit of unself-consciously touching the person she is talking to, all of this lends her a charm that appeals to women as well as to men. Lucy emerges from the bathroom. What does she do next? I know that she doesn't write in her diary, which has been neglected for almost 2 weeks. She doesn't call Scott, her boyfriend, who serves on the American aircraft carrier in the port city of Yokosuka. Later, among her personal possessions, her family will find an unsent postcard, addressed to her great friend from home, Samantha Berman. Perhaps she writes that card now. Darling Sammy, just a little note from Tokyo to say how good it was to talk to you the other evening. I'm so glad you found a lovely friend-slash-guy-slash-mate, whatever he is. I know it's easier for me over here as my everyday life has changed and Sundays are so different at the moment, but I wanted to let you know that life is incomplete without you. And although I'm not sure when, we will be together soon, be it wherever I am or me back home. I do love you and miss you terribly and always will. All my love, Lulu. At 1:30, the telephone rings downstairs. One of the other flatmates answers and calls from below. It is for Lucy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.